wants to play a Superboy.
This is Jason J. Lewis, the voice of Superman on Justice League Action.
This is Mark Waid, writer of Superman Birthright.
And you're listening to The Krypton Report.
And you're listening to Krypton Report.
Up in the sky, look!
It's a bird!
It's a plane!
All things Kryptonian podcast, including Superman and Supergirl.
We discuss games, movies, cartoons, TV shows, and comics.
Find us on Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, and Twitter.
As a bird, as a plane, as Supergirl.
Welcome to the Krypton Report. It is my beautiful blue self, Tyler. And with me is the lovely James Superman Red. And also the all-inspiring Brian Peters, the Batman, to our Superman club here.
I'm Batman.
So we got an idea for an episode. I don't know if you listeners listened back. A couple of episodes ago, we were talking about, you know, it seemed like when people talk about Superman stories, all that ever matters is origins and death. And we got talking about that. And Brian, he found a quote by Batman that basically said it was from Final Crisis. No, Infinite Crisis.
No, it's from Infinite Crisis issue 1.
And it basically states that Batman says to Superman, "The last time you ever inspired anyone is when you died." And it got us talking about that. So today we're just going to talk about some of our favorite Superman hopeful moments and different stories that we've really liked that brings us hope, because at this time right now, man, we could really use just some hope and some happiness and some upbeat inspirational songs about life.
Absolutely.
So, and if anyone got that reference, more power to you. Just crack an egg on it. Which is my favorite part in that movie. But
the Robin song.
Oh my gosh, I love it.
Or just the saying.
I love the Robin song, but I just love the crack an egg on it.
It's funny how the movies, I mean, I like Teen Titans Go. My kids love it. It's funny how the movies are just like a bunch of episodes like strung together almost like a long story, you know, but it seems like it's like a bunch of the episodes. They're almost like shorts, you know, building up to the whole thing. But the, it's funny how the movies are. I think the movies are better than the show.
It is. I will watch Teen Titans Go versus Teen Titans. And I will watch Teen Titans Go to the movies before I'll watch the show, the actual show. But we're not here to talk about the Teen Titans. We're here to talk about Superman. So, without further ado,
if only they brought Superboy into Teen Titans Go,
right?
Then we'd talk about it.
We would have another super to talk about.
Yeah,
I think Sailor and I are gonna power watch some superhero girls. So I'll have some. I can talk about that later too.
Nice.
You definitely should.
Who wants to kick off this good, old, fun family Christmas? I'm just going to reference National Lampoon as much as I can. Who cares? All right.
Hey, do you want me? No, I found that whole entire talk in Infinite Crisis, if you want to say the whole thing.
No, because that's too much contextual. That's too much contextual, you know, about that particular story.
Okay. Gosh.
Start with something like that, and maybe Luther's speech in Last Son.
No, Luther's speech in Last Son.
I agree.
Great. But who?
Okay. We'll start there.
All right. So there. We're gonna start with a segment that is Lex Luthor, and will you introduce Brian, the book, and the creative team behind the book?
Okay, I don't remember who did the art on it, it was Adam Kubert, that's right, one of the greatest of all time. So a little bit after Infinite Crisis, where that whole conversation with Batman comes from, and Batman says the only last time you inspired anybody is when you died, Superman, which was really harsh, real big jab there. They kind of give us kind of a rebooted retelling of Superman's first encounter with General Zod. So what's happened here in this story called Last Son, written by Richard Donner, as you know, gave us Superman the movie and Superman 2 the movie with Christopher Reeve. So this has a very Christopher Reeve-y Superman kind of telling to it. But basically what happens is a ship crashes in Metropolis or on Earth.
It's written by Jeff Johns and Richard Donner.
Richard Donner and Jeff Johns, the greats. And the ship crashes on Earth, and lo and behold, there's a child inside. So the government snatches him pretty quick. And Superman wants to know what's up with this kid. And they basically discover that this child is Kryptonian. So Superman wants to, of course, raise the kid immediately. He wants the kid to be safe. Lois is kind of iffy on it. I don't know. You know, what are we going to do? What story are we going to tell? I think this kind of really sets the groundwork for Jonathan Kent, if anything, for sure. But we find out that this kid actually belongs to General Zod. And this kid, his name is Lor Zod. Mm. Correct me if I'm wrong.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So Zod and Ursa were in Fort Roz, which is trapped in the Phantom Zone. And in Fort Roz, time can actually go. Time keeps flowing in Fort Roz. So they have a kid, yada, yada. And because the kid was born in Fort Roz, creates a little bit of a doorway to get out of the Phantom Zone. So, yada, yada, this kid crashes. Zod comes after his kid. And they start this kind of a debate and fight about how this kid should be and how this kid should be raised. And Superman knows the only way he can stop Zod from kind of taking over Earth with all the Kryptonians from Fort Roz and, you know, create a new Krypton, is he has to work with Luther. And Superman's here with Luther, and he says, "Why am I still alive, Luther, if you want to kill all these Kryptonians?" And he says, "I'm alive because you know you can't stop General Zod without me." Luther laughs, as only he can, and he says, yes, of course. Like all the other sheep in Metropolis, I'm afraid to strive for new heights because I could never become what the great and powerful Man of Steel is. You've taught humanity to rely on you and not fight for themselves. That's why General Zod and his army were able to take control. I kill you now. You're a martyr. You survive this, and the world finally sees Kryptonians for what they really are, alien invaders. You lose everything, their undying trust, their endless love. And Superman says, you underestimate the people in Metropolis. Luther says, you overestimate them. They need someone to wake them up. They need someone to show them that they can reach the stars without you flying them up there. They need someone human to aspire to. And Superman says, and that's you? And Luther says, if not for you getting in my way, Superman, I would have done so much more for humanity already. I would have helped those who can't walk, walk again. I would have cured cancer. I would have saved the world from the filthy pit of its lackadaisical existence. You leap over tall buildings. You outrun speeding bullets. You juggle locomotives. How does that inspire anybody to be a better human being? Have you really looked at the situation we're in, Superman? You claim for years that you're the last son of Krypton. In truth, there are dozens of others. Your people simply chosen in prison and forget about. Now they're free from this pocket dimension, this Phantom Zone, and they're all criminals. And Superman says, but not the boy. The boy is innocent. And gosh, that just like, I mean, really thinking here. You know, Superman is this godlike figure. Does he really inspire us Because I can never fly. I can never juggle locomotives. I can never stop a bullet. But I might be able, through science, to be able to do great scientific things. So this really begs a real question. Does Superman really inspire, or does he create this dependency on a godlike figure to kind of do things for us? Or is this things that Superman does even obtainable for man?
Well, okay. So that's really the tipping point of the conversation. We can talk about one thing is Superman, and in different books, today I reread Superman Unchained, and Sam Lane talks to him about, he says things like, you could go into and stop the dictator, overthrow the dictator, but then another one pops up. And part of that goes to the fact that Superman, the things that he does is things a lot of times we can't do for ourselves, or he's trying to show a better way to do things. And the biggest aspect is, we're not going to talk about the side stories like Red Sun or Injustice, where he becomes full-on evil Superman dictator.
Yeah.
But the idea is he has these powers. And part of the inspiration is his character. Because if he wanted to, he could force his will on people. If he wanted to, he could get away with whatever. Like, he could do crime. He could, everyone bow to him, worship him, but he doesn't. He chooses to live the life that he does and to act the way that he does as an example. I mean, I don't want to sit here and bash or get into deep theological discussions or religious discussions, but it's the same kind of aspiration that a lot of people with the Christ-like figure look at, is it's something that's unobtainable, but yet you strive to be that. And it's kind of the same concept as someone his values. That's inspiration, that he's like, I don't tell a lie. And that's part of that whole truth story that's going on now in Bendis's writing is, the one thing that he's always had to lie about is that he is Clark Kent as well. And he wants to end that. So, the fact that he does the right thing. He always tries, to find the scenario where he doesn't have to kill. Like I said, I read Unchained. And if you've ever read that story, it's a very interesting situation that he's put in. And he even then is trying to find a way not to kill. It's his values and his moral compass that really is the aspirational part. And the fact that he allows humanity to make their own mistakes. And in Luther's speech here, where Luther talks about, I could have done this, I could have done that, which echoes also kind of in All-Star Superman. Or am I thinking about All-Star Superman? I'm trying to remember. But basically, he's like, then why didn't you?
Yep.
He's like, Luther, you could have done all of this. Yep. Why didn't you? Because, I think one of the best examples for me is, it's in Superman Doomsday, the animated movie, is where Lex figures out how to cure cancer and then tells Mercy, how can we slow it down to make it a lifelong treatment? And then it cuts to Superman in the fortress trying to figure out how to stop it.
Yes. Yes.
So, and that's why Lex Luthor, as a villain, has always been kind of that dichotomy to Superman. Of Superman has these powers and he's super, but it's his moral compass and the person he is versus someone who is a human who has reached perfection and has become more, but yet he reflects the greed, the selfishness, the self-interest. And we'll get into this more as we go.
Well, you go through Luther's speech there, and all the stuff he could do for the world that he doesn't do, for one, he doesn't put his, exactly. his he doesn't put his knowledge in his acumen to the betterment of humankind. So the fact that, you know, focusing on, yes, I would love to be able to fly. Yes, I would love to, have super strength and be invulnerable and stop people from doing things that they do to hurt other people. But Superman, inspires people to be more than what they are, to be better, to be good, and to, treat people as equals. Even if you can't achieve something, he's an alien. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. His abilities are not attainable by people in this world, in the comic book world and obviously in our world. You can't attain that, but his morals, his ethics, treating people and helping people, if everybody did something to help another person. Now, it doesn't have to be anything that's going to put you out. It's not going to be helping somebody that's going to helping somebody in a way that is going to be of a detriment to you. Mm-hmm. You know, that you have to sacrifice something of your own, your health, maybe a little bit of time, some people will, but not everybody has to give their last dollar, to help somebody out. But if everybody did something to help somebody else, just enough to pass on a little bit of goodwill, to the next person. And if everybody did that, even just once, not even once a day, but once in a while, you know what I mean? Because not everybody always has the opportunity to help somebody every single day. But if everybody helps somebody once in a while, to step out of their own lives a little bit and thought about what somebody else needed or what they could do to help somebody, the world would be in a lot better place. Unfortunately, too many people in the world think more like Lex Luthor. What do I get out of it? And what is somebody else's use to me?
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
So,
Superman inspires people just to help one another and be a good person. You can help somebody by just listening. Some people have a lot that they keep inside. You could listen to a random stranger vent and unload a little bit, and that person might walk away feeling so much better about themselves that day or for a little while. You could do that to a random stranger and, it would help. So there's a lot that people can do that Superman inspires, it's not just inspiring people to, step in front of bullets, mm-hmm. Stopping crime and all that other stuff. Would a lot of us love to be able to do that? Of course. To be a first responder, like a police officer or a firefighter or a paramedic or something like that, there's a lot of people who can do that. And there's a lot of people who can't do that, but that doesn't mean that you can't be a good person and that you can't help, that you can't have a good set of morals and ethics, and that you can't think about what a little bit of your time could do for somebody else, as opposed to the other way around.
I want to jump back real quick to something you said about doing good. Example, Superman Shazam, the animated short. He's trying to teach Shazam.
Love it.
When he's fighting Black Adam and he's talking about, you know, Shazam wants to stop Black Adam. He says, make the hard choice. Be good. And how many times, like, Superman knows his power, but he has to restrain himself. And that, you know, restraint is an example of doing something, putting forth action because you are showing your strong will. BVS has the statement of he's just a man trying to do the right thing. You know, he has these abilities. Now, we are all given abilities, gifts, talents in life. And, you know, let's jump over to the other side real quick. Let's talk about somebody else real quick. Spider-Man.
Well, real quick, a man trying to do the right thing. You know, one thing I've always loved that about Superman is that he's not a god. You know what I mean? Some people will look up at him as a godlike figure, but he's just a man trying to do the right thing. Sometimes he makes mistakes because he's just a man, but that's it. He's a man doing what he can. There's a lot he can do that other people can't. You know what I mean? So there's plenty that everybody can do. And it doesn't have to be super.
You know,
it just has to be something.
Spider-Man's whole thing was built around with great power comes great responsibility. And having his power, he now has an innate responsibility to use that for the benefit of others. And that's what Superman does. He has this ability. He could do nothing. He could just work on the Kent farm and be the most profitable farmer. Or, you know, he could just be Clark Kent and write. But he chooses to be Superman. That's the thing. That was part of, like, the arc of the Man of Steel film, as well as, you know, the arc in Smallville, the series, as well as Superman Earth 1 that we've reviewed, is he chooses to be Superman. He doesn't have to. He can just do his thing, stay in the shadows, but he eventually chooses to come out as Superman and to be a light.
Well, that's even Diane Lane's speech in Batman versus Superman.
Exactly.
So,
but you know, he chooses to do that. And the thing is, how much of his personal self-sacrifice and everything does, you know, he have to give up in life to be Superman for other people, to be something for other people, to not think about himself, to be selfless. And that's the biggest thing is, we all have our talents and abilities, but how selfless are we with them? Do we use those to help others? Do we think of others before ourselves? Because these are all factors that play into his character and why he's a hope and why he's an inspiration. You know, why I think inspiration is probably better than saying hope at times, because I think with an inspirational actor, an inspirational thing, it gives hope. I'm going to jump real quick, and then I'm going to pass it back to Brian here. But I couldn't find all the issues, but the truth run that they did a few years back in Action and in Superman, where he was being depowered, one of the best issues before they screwed up the story arc was Superman, as he was losing his powers, stood up to the police because they were going to they were evacuating and taking people's homes. And it was illegal search and seizure. And he did not have his full power. He did not have his strength. But he stood there against this injustice and stood up for these people. And his thing, and we've heard it in how many different incarnations and videos, I fight for those who can't fight for themselves. I mean, how selfless is that? Like, someone who is about peace doesn't want to fight, but he's like, I will fight for those who can't fight for themselves. Standing up for others. All All right, so I'm going to pass it back over to Brian. Let's see what you got for some of the stuff that you've been reading. Just kind of...
So I know that we didn't want to kind of tap into Superman's origin, and we wanted to find other things. But as I was kind of looking through Superman's stories and, you know, reading Earth One again and even looking at Last Son, what hit me a lot about Last Son is that Christopher Kent, as Clark and Lois call him, you know, this kid grew up in Fort Ross, and he was tortured. He was beaten by Zod. They did a lot of experiments on him, you know, I think to see, you know, if he would have certain abilities. I'm trying to remember. But the main thing is this kid had a horrible childhood. And then he comes to Earth, and he stays with Clark and Lois, and he sees this different side of what a Kryptonian could be. He sees this side of what an Earthling could be. He sees a different future of what he could be. And that's an inspiration in itself. And I started thinking about, you know, how I grew up and me as a kid. And, you know, I don't want to get all mushy and, you know, get too personal here, you know, but if you know, my dad left when I was a little baby, you know, when I was just 6 months old, and I saw him here and there. And I often wonder sometimes, you know, if I would have had my dad around, how I would have turned out, you know, not to say my dad is like General Zod, but my dad was a little bit evil like Zod, very selfish, you know, horrible guy. And I think that the fact that Superman didn't know his biological parents very well, you know, he was raised by the Kents, and they were amazing people, and he probably would have turned out fine and did wonderful things at the farm by himself. And he would have became a reporter and take the powers away. He still would have done great things. And then I looked at Batman because, you know, I love Batman. And I think if Bruce's parents never died, if he never had that moment, you know, where Bruce really died and he became Batman, and what would have Bruce done? You know, Bruce would have been a philanthropist, no doubt. He would have used his money to help people, but he never would have trained his mind and his body to be the best as humanly possible. You know, the good side of the good version of Lex Luthor, almost, if you get to say, you know, using that mind to fight crime and make sure no one became like that. But the inspiring thing about Superman, even compared to Batman here, and even compared to those in this world, you know, that are victims of child abuse and had that horrible upbringing. You know, maybe you grew up poor. I know I grew up in the projects. I grew up on welfare. You know, the inspiring thing about Superman to me was that my parents' decisions and where I came from, my environment and how I grew up, that doesn't define me. That doesn't define what I could be. Mm-hmm. And in reading Last Son, what really hit me is that, you know, Lor Zod or Christopher, he could have been just like his dad. He spent more time with his dad. But, you know, in my life, it was those people having a positive impact to me. You know, when I was 4 years old and I saw Christopher Reeve on that movie screen, you know, well, like old VHS tape, and I saw how Superman was and this larger-than-life character and just helping people and just being nice and just, you know, and just doing the right thing – that made me think that, you know, I could be better than I am. I could be better than my real dad, you know, and Christopher made the choice to be like Superman, to follow those positive values, to show hope to people, to make those sacrifices. In the end, he had to make the sacrifice and blast everybody back in the Phantom Zone to save Earth, you know. And I think if Superman teaches us anything, it's that our origins and where we're from, and even in Batman as well, that doesn't define who we are. Our choices in life define where we can go and who we can be as a person. And maybe someone else is struggling too, like James said. You know, in our world today, there's a lot of people struggling. There's a lot of people that don't have jobs. You know, there's a lot of single moms. Like, I talked to a single mom that's a waitress, and she lost her job. You know, there's a lot of people struggling out there. And if Superman inspires anything and Superman teaches anything, it's to be more than a normal human, to go out there and help people and just be kind. Just go do all you can to make the world a better place. And that makes us as humans better people. And what makes Superman greater than Batman, yeah, I'm saying it, is that Batman holds on to that pain. Superman overcomes that pain. And that's the most hopeful, inspirational thing you could ever think of.
You know, actually going off of that right now, I just finished reading For Tomorrow from Brian Azzarello and Jim Lee artwork. And I've heard some things back and forth. Some people love it, some people don't. I mean, one, Jim Lee's art is always just phenomenal. Absolutely. One of my favorite artists of all time. It's just his style. I love it. So I just read For Tomorrow, and in it, Superman, you talk about overcoming pain and stuff like that. And I brought up the fact that, you know, Superman makes mistakes, in that there's a device, and it's linked to the Phantom Zone, and he creates a utopia in the Phantom Zone. And like it sends people there. And I mean, just, I'm not going to go into how it works or anything like that, 'cause it's kind of like a random thing, to begin with, until he's able to investigate it, use it and focus it. But he creates a world to be able to do what his father couldn't. Krypton died, Krypton exploded, and he was the last survivor of Krypton, beyond anybody who, like Zod, who wasn't trapped in the Phantom Zone. And he created this utopia, this world for the possible future. If Earth follows suit, if Earth were to be destroyed, by natural means or other. And, you know, it's in the story, like, even when he creates that, like, giving people everything, even when people have everything, it's not enough. You know, there's some that just, that's just completely different. You know, that I don't know why, you know, that some people just need more, or some people can't be good or that just even everything isn't enough, you know? But he tries to plan ahead and create a world to help when this, you know, when this world ends. And like, it's a mistake, and it causes him and a lot of other people some, and a lot of other people, pain. So, but he learns from his mistake. I mean, he, in overall, it's, you know, he's lucky that it wasn't some kind of, dire thing that a bunch of people, ended up dying in that case. But, you know, it separated millions of people from their families and things like that. You know, Superman, because of the pain that he knew, you know, being all alone as he is, the last survivor of his race and his planet being destroyed and wanting to be proactive, you know, he ended up making a mistake because of that pain, but he learned from it and, you know, tries to move forward and do something better. I have the page of All-Star up here, and I want to get back to the end of For Tomorrow, because I found a lot in that story to be really just really good writing. You know, Superman questioning, huh?
Oh, I was just saying, hey, amen. I mean, that.
Oh, okay.
Those panels that you're about to talk about, just probably some of the most powerful Superman stuff ever.
Yeah, For Tomorrow was great. You know, like I said, I hadn't read that yet, and I've been wanting to read it for a while. The stuff I've read so far of Azzarello has been really good, and like I said, it's Jim Lee's art, so. I needed to see it. I needed to definitely, flip through the book, through the pages. And I apologize here. My internet is taking forever. Apparently.
It's okay. It happens to the best of us.
Yeah.
Only the best of us.
So, all right. It's almost there. It's loading up slowly.
You know, like everything you're saying, it drives home, like, back to what you said. He is a man doing the best that he can and is trying to do things better. And that's something that, you know, we all experience is, you know, we try to do something, we make an error, we continue. And I think people, like you said, they put this God level on him, and he's not. He's not. He's just a man. I mean, there's great stories that are written where he's depowered. I mean, there are great episodes of Smallville where Clark don't have his powers, and he still does what he thinks is right and does the best that he can for people. So, and it goes back to, like, what Brian was saying. Some of it can be a nature versus nurture argument of what we choose to embrace. And what we choose to do.
So I finally got it up here. So here in the end of the Phantom Zone, like, Zod is in the Phantom Zone, and like, there was nothing. It was the empty, timeless existence that the Phantom Zone is more commonly known to be. And Superman and Zod basically are equally tied to the existence of this world that he created. And during their fight, the world is shattering around them. And, I mean, I'm going to have a little bit to read here, but the world is destroyed. It's literally like the world is blowing up again around them. And he's, what does it mean when a man whose life is built on faith sacrifices it by saving his own life? And what does it mean when a man is willing to sacrifice his own life for what he believes in? And Superman is trying to save Zod, a guy who only wanted to kill him and make him suffer and destroy the world he had created. And it says, I don't know. All over Earth, the vanished appeared. It's unsettling, and not just for them, but an understanding is instantly shared. An empathy I see in their eyes is as if I could read minds. I can help. I want to help. And they do. They help everyone but me. All I want at this moment is to hold my wife and never let her go. But they would never allow that to happen. So I go. Knowing you will forget the vanishing, it will take time, but it will come to pass. The living of life will see to it in the wake of threats and catastrophes yet to happen. The living of life has a way of making the important a memory. And while I construct a new fortress of solitude built surrounded by life instead of ice, I think about my life, about my loves, about my home, about my fight, and about you. I will always be there to save you because I am Superman. Believe that until the end. The end. I wonder when it comes, who will save me? Like, the book ends on a question like that. Was this like a 10-issue arc, I think it was?
I need to read this.
It ends with that question. Who will save me? Like, it's not even that, he's not even talking about like the end of the world, the end of everything. I mean, just his life, his faith, what people sacrifice to help others and to save others. Like, I think that's powerful, for just to think about helping, and being there for others, being there for the people you love, being there for, people you don't know.
And exactly. I mean, that's what, we're getting at. And I know we weren't touching on like origin and like death stories, but I just wanted to point out that's part of why like the battle between Superman and Doomsday is so powerful of a story beat, is because, like with Zod, Superman tries to save everyone first. He doesn't want to kill. He doesn't want to go in there and just destroy someone. He always is holding back something. But, with Doomsday, it was like, this is a beast that's going to kill everything that I have to protect. And he chose to fight till it was done. Even if that meant killing himself, because he was willing to sacrifice to protect. Now, I'm going to change it up here with a story that I defend, because I feel like there is stuff in here that I really like, and there are some Superman fans who do not like it. But I have Superman Grounded Volume 1. And I recommend Volume 1. I haven't reread Volume 2. I don't own Volume 2. But I remember when I read Volume 2, I really didn't like it. And I found out that's because J. Michael Straczynski left the book at that time. And J. Michael Straczynski wrote the Earth 1 series, which we've talked about, that we all really love. So, in Superman Grounded, the base story of Volume 1 is, after New Krypton, Superman just feels detached from people. And after an event, He's just walking across the U.S. Okay? And I'm going to read. There's two different things. There's like three things I'm going to pull from this book. And I'm not going to like basically ruin the book for anyone. But the first one is, if you're looking in the graphic novel, well, it's, I think, made up of four issues. It's in issue one. There's no page markers, but it's the police looking up, and Superman shows up, and he says, "Is there a jumper?" And they say, "Yes, what happened?" "We can't figure out what's going on." Cop says to Superman, "Don't suppose you'd like to go up there and just grab her, would you?" He said, "No, because one of Superman's rules was he was going to walk. He wasn't going to fly above everyone. He wanted to be part of it." And he flies up, and he says, "Hello," and the girl's name is Felicity. And he says, "I thought we might be able to talk a bit and understand what had been going through." She begins yelling, "Don't you dare touch me. I know that you're just going to take me and take me down." She says, "Somebody said when you give your word, you never break it. Is that true?" He says, "Yes." "Then I want your word to promise you won't take me down by force, and that if I jump, I choose to jump because it's my choice and you won't stop me." And it's the next panel is his face frozen, and he says, "I give you my word. I won't stop you. I won't take you back down against your will." So the next panel is the cops kind of looking puzzled, and it's her basically venting and talking to Superman. And she says, you know, she points out stuff that it's not fair in life. And I'm not going to say everything because I really think you should read it. But he says, she says first, "It's not fair. None of it is fair. And don't you dare tell me it is." He says, "I won't, because you're right. It's not fair. John Lennon is dead. And Gaddafi is still alive. JFK is dead and Castro is alive. Gandhi is dead, but Manson keeps hanging in there. It's not fair, but it's not unfair either. It just is." And she says, "That's the best you can do." He's like, "Because it's truth." And he starts talking about, you know, telling her kind of his story. He says, "Sometimes you don't think about saving the whole world. You just think about saving one person." And he talks about having to try. And she says, "I just want to rest for a bit." He says, "Okay. When you rest, I'll be here ready." Now, to give you a visual of this, is she's on the ledge of a building, and he's just flying and floating above her. And the next page is 6 panels. And each panel is the exact same thing, but the sun's getting darker. And time is passing. And the police turn on a spotlight. And she says, "Can you have them turn it off? It hurts my eyes." And then the next panel, he uses his heat vision to turn off the light. And then she starts talking and says, "There's a lot of people down there." She says, "Yes, I've seen people splatted on the sidewalk before. Are you sure you want to do that to them?" And she states, "I don't know. I don't feel like I know anything." And he says, "Can I make a suggestion?" And it's really powerful, and I'm a little teary-eyed, I admit, reading it, just because I feel like there's so many people that are dealing with, and I don't know if I've ever told you guys this or talked about this on the podcast. I used to work with troubled teenagers. I worked in a locked facility and I worked on the teenage girls wing, and I dealt a lot with girls who attempted suicide, who were cutters, who had come from broken homes, who had been abused and everything like this. And it took a big toll on me. I was young. I was still in college, and I was working on my counseling degree and everything. And it took a big toll on me. So stuff like this really puts me back in the mindset of sitting with those girls and talking. And so I'm going to try to read this without getting kind of choked up about it, okay? Superman says, "A friend of mine many years ago took her life. She was terminally ill, and every day was agony. She decided one day she knew without a question that she would never have another happy day. And she, well, I guess she couldn't say I guess you could say she checked out early. I understood. I didn't approve. Still don't, but I understood. And he turns to her and he says, if you can honestly believe in your heart of hearts that you will never, ever have another happy day, then step out in the air and I'll keep my promise. And I won't stop you. And he says, but if you think there's a chance, no matter how small, that another happy day will be out there, then take my hand. And she takes her hand, and the last page is a full, it's a full spread. And she's just crying. And he says, you're safe. And then the next page is he brought her, you know, her down. And the officer says, would you have really let her fall? And Superman just looks at him and says, good night, officer, and walks away. And I love it. You know, I think it is just one of the things that just.
Yeah, you got me crying, okay?
He has all the power that he could have forced his will on her. You know, he could have done whatever he wanted to, but then she would have just done it again or worse, you know, but he just talked to her. And I think that's the superpower that so many of us have, is just the ability to listen and talk to people. Years ago, I wrote a blog, and it actually helped me get my job that I worked for a while as a newspaper reporter until I left because the paper, small town paper, had a lot of problems and they just weren't trying to pay us. But that's a whole nother story. But basically, I wrote about why I like wearing my Superman shirt. And after a while, I got to the point where I wouldn't wear clothes or anything that represented anything that didn't have a connection to my beliefs. And I put down, like, I wear because the Superman symbol is so recognized and has such a unique purpose about a value system and what Superman and who Superman is compared to if someone wore a shirt with a religious symbol, because it seems like religion causes more division and fighting. But you can have two people from two different religions who can both idolize Superman. And how that character has such a strong grasp in culture that it's a symbol and a set of code and a morals and what is pure goodness that all people can be behind. And I want people to see that not just because I have this shirt on or because I have Superman tattooed on my chest doesn't mean that I am Superman. It just means that I stand behind a set of beliefs that we can all share and we can all be a part of. And, you know, all that to say is just, what does that say about a character that all people can share in? You know, what is it, the two most recognized characters on the planet, Superman and Mickey Mouse? Probably Batman. But what does that say about a character that was created about the shared common just energy of this character, of what it brings out in people? Who want to inspire and aspire to do the right thing. I don't know. I'll pass it back to you guys. I got another story here in my book, but I'll throw it back out there for you guys to kind of to do one.
You got something on your mind there, Brian?
Yeah. you know, I've kind of always been known as the comic book nerd and the geeky guy, and a lot of, you know, some of my other friends, not you guys, sometimes even my wife, they get on me by the fact that I'm always wearing like a graphic tee. I'm always wearing a Superman or a superhero shirt all the time. People give me crap about it all the time, whether it's a Superman shirt or, you know, like a Spider-Man shirt, a Hulk shirt, whatever. And they get on me all the time. But Tyler, I because you share what you shared, I think I'll share a little personal story here. I don't know if I ever told you the guys this story. I don't even know if I told my wife it. I don't know. But anywho, I'm going to try not to cry about this one, but, you know, I also used to work with kids. I'm a former youth minister myself, my wife and I, that's actually kind of how we met. And when I was about 17 years old, I was a camp counselor in Pennsylvania and where I grew up. And as a camp counselor, you have to notice certain things about the kids that you deal with. And we were dealing with like a lot of inner city kids, kids with a lot of issues. Maybe they grew up like in the projects, their parents, may have been in prison, something like that. And, it was my first year as a counselor. I was, I think, 17 then. And, we had a kid in a cabin that, he wouldn't go to the bathroom with anyone else in the bathroom. And, I was just a little 17-year-old kid, I didn't pick up on things right away always. But none of my other counselors really noticed that. And I thought it was really weird. And he never would really bathe. He wouldn't do any of that. And I started noticing, I only had like 5 nights with the kid. I started noticing that kind of like night two. And then he also wet the bed like every night. And being the younger of the counselors, I always had to clean that up. Sorry, this is kind of hard. But basically, I pulled the kid aside, and I said, is everything kind of going okay? I'm just a little worried about you, buddy. Why are you worried? I was like, well, is something scaring you at night? If something's scaring you, I can move your bed kind of closer to the counselor's room, if you need anything. And he said nothing was scaring him, but he said he wanted to move his bed actually farthest away from the counselor room. and he kind of didn't want anybody to be near him. I was like, okay. So I did that for him. And he still kept wetting the bed, still would not use the restroom when any other kids was in there. When any adult was around, he would not go in the bathroom. And I told my senior, my boss, I said, I think something's going on with this kid, and I don't really know what's going on. And my superior, my boss, said, it seems like the kid is showing signs of child abuse. And if we can find out what's going on, then, we got to report it. We got to say what's going on at the home. That was a lot. I felt a lot of pressure on me, So
of course
I threw on a Superman shirt and, because I needed to feel strong. And, later that night I set the kid down and, it was just him and I in the whole cabin. The kids were, the other boys were, across the lake, camping out. And well, they went ahead, and so I sat there with him, and my boss was in the other room, just for safety's sake. And I sat him down, and I said, hey, what's really going on with you? And he basically said that that he was abused by his father's boyfriend. His father's boyfriend, his mom's boyfriend, one night, mom was, passed out on drugs and basically that's that. And, So I had to report it, and the kid left early because of child services, and never saw the kid, never knew what happened after that. But when the before the kid left, and you know, and he left camp, he came to me and he said thanks for, he said, I appreciate you being so nice to me while I was here, you know. I was really embarrassed, and the kid was probably about maybe 9 or something. He's like, I was really embarrassed, but you know, he never made me feel bad. And, you know, it gave me some hope that, you know, there's some good adults out there. you know, and my boss from that moment on, every year I worked at camp, he always called me Superman. And I kind of got that nickname at camp. And, but I never really needed to be, have any recognition or anything like that. I never needed that. But sometimes just a Superman shirt or just the symbol of Superman, you know, it throws that extra layer of protection. I don't know what I'm saying, but no. Like it shows that international symbol, kind of like what you're saying, of that's something we can understand, you know, that things are going to be okay. And if there's anything that Superman, you know, teaches us, is just save somebody, you know. And I hope that kid's doing okay, and I hope that the girls that you dealt with are doing okay, and I'm sure they are. But like, life just throws stuff at us so much, and if we can be that light to people, if we can be that hero to people, then we need to do it, you know.
I'm gonna take.
That's all I have to say about that.
I'm gonna take over and do my story, because my story definitely ties into exactly what you're talking about, and it is another chapter. It's from the fourth book of the first volume of Grounded, and it starts with a boy who is painting a giant Superman sign that he's gonna hang on his house, because he heard that Superman in his walk will be walking through his town. And the kids are asking, what are you doing? And he says, Superman can do anything. He can make my mom love me again, and my dad, he'll make my dad stop. And his dad shows up behind him. His dad tears up the thing and tells him to get in the house. The next thing we see, the kid has a bruised eye, and the kid is talking, and he says, why does dad hate me? And the mom's trying to talk to the children, saying, oh, he doesn't, to the son. And the kid's saying, it's going to be okay. Superman's coming. He'll fix it. He'll fix it for both of us. And the kid puts his sign up. And he comes back inside. He's wearing his Superman t-shirt. And it looks like it's the next day, but it doesn't really say that. But if you just look at the context clues, it kind of feels like it. But we're not sure. And the dad's fighting with the mom. And the kid stands up and gets in front and says, leave her alone. Dad takes the kid to the basement, beats on him, throws him in. And the...
oh, man.
Superman's walking by, and he hears it. And the artwork is great. But the kid says, Superman. And then the next page is him in the basement with a child. And this is one of those stories where, so the dad comes in, okay, and he doesn't realize who it is. And it says, Superman says, I could have torn him apart. And Lois is actually there. And he says, she says, I know. He says, he beat them. And she's like, I know, for no reason. And you see the anger in his face. And this is one of those things where he had to show restraint. Because Superman literally could have just murdered this guy. And he gives the kid a number and says, call this number every day and leave me a voicemail. And if I don't hear from you, I'll be back. Basically. And it just gets me because of like everything you said and we said is like, there are a lot of hurting kids in this world.
That really got to me.
There's a lot of hurting kids in this world, and I wish, you know, we had more power. But it also just comes up for each one of us to just stand up. If we know something, we see something, we say something. And that's an inspiration right there, you know? And this book does have some stuff of Superman doing Superman things, but at the same time, there's a lot of small personal stories in it. And that's why those two especially is why I appreciate this book. But I'm going to throw it back over to James to take over, because Brian and I have been talking for a while. James, if you're still with us, or if you're, you know, hurled up and crying in the corner like us.
Right. No, I'm here.
Yeah, James, please talk. Please talk, James.
All right. I don't have as hard-hitting emotional stories personally dealt with. I am open to All-Star Superman, where Superman is talking with Lois, and he's hearing things. And says, hey, watch where you're pushing. Cancel that backup, Shelley. We're good. Regan, oh, God, I'm on my way. Where did you say you wanted to go, buddy? Take it easy. Take it easy. Don't put the phone down. I have to go, Lois. Someone needs me. And the next page, there is a young girl standing on a ledge of a building, and she drops her cell phone. It's a young girl who is contemplating suicide. And Superman just shows up and he says, your doctor really did get held up, Regan. It's never as bad as it seems. You're much stronger than you think you are. Trust me. And she hugs him. Like, that's, you know, one page, with five panels, and just four lines from Superman. And, you know, something like that could give somebody the strength to carry on, you know?
Yeah.
Acknowledgement, concern, you know, just giving somebody a shoulder to cry on, you know, that can be something small like that can just be what somebody needs to make it through, to think about from day to day, you know, that things may not be as bad as they seem. You know, you can get caught up, you know, just something like this, you know, you can get caught up in your own emotions, in your own world, and in the problems that you're dealing with immediately. But those things aren't going to last forever.
No.
You know, you have the strength and you can give that strength to people, and you can get strength from other people. Just, it doesn't have to be it doesn't have to be, you know, a miracle. Mm-hmm. You know, just a true, honest human interaction can make all the difference in the world.
You know, and I think, and I say this, just, you know, watch. If you're not much of a reader, just watch, you know, a Superman show, or you will see these themes. You will see the actual character come out and why there's the inspirational mark. Why, you know, there's the thing about Superman representing hope is because there is a hope for a better. Like, they call him the Man of Tomorrow, and it's not because he's an alien with his powers. It's, you know, his character. When I'm like right now, you know, if anyone ever really paid attention, I always change the Facebook page's background on our Krypton Report Facebook page. I change it every day, put something new for fun. But I left the one that I have now for a while because we are dealing with a dark time. And it is the quote from the recent crisis on Infinite Earths episode with Brandon Routh playing Superman, when Lois asked why he blacked it out. And he says, "Hope is the light that lifts us out of darkness." And, I mean, in these trying times, like, what more than we need a world of hope? This is going to sound funny, but one of my favorite songs, actually, when I was a kid, I had the Power Rangers soundtrack from the TV series, and Ron Wasserman was the musician who wrote and recorded all these songs, and I actually have his, he redid them, I have that album now, he did that a couple years ago, but the song "We Need a Hero," and if anyone ever watched Power Rangers, you know, like, they would morph, and then there'd be, like, these songs that would play in the background as they're fighting the putties or whatever, but if you ever get a chance to look at the words to that song, the chorus says, "If we keep dreaming in a world where good is all that we can find, we need a hero." And, you know, that's the thing is, like, we might not have, you know, superheroes or whatever, but we all can be a hero for our morality, the choices we make, the how we treat other people, and just being an example. You know, James, you're, in a ways, you're a hero to your children by the example that you set for them. Brian, you are a hero to that kid by the compassion and the example you set as a counselor. And we have a responsibility to be the best versions of us so that we can make impressions on other people. Was there any other story points that we had? Like, I feel like we've gotten really emotionally heavy, and there are examples that we had picked out.
Even though it got emotionally heavy, you know, it's about the positive and you know, bringing light to somebody else's life, and you know, helping them and giving them something else to think about, and something else to use and move on in their lives in a positive manner.
Brian, any final quotes, thoughts?
I really don't have any words right now. No, I mean, if there's one thing that you know, we three guys here, and Junia and Solo and Selah and Bell and James and, you know, whole Krypton Report family, if there's anything that we want to do in all our talks, is not only talk about Superman and not only about all the ongoings of DC Comics stuff, but we hope that You know, what we talk about and what we say, and the words of Superman and the actions of Superman and the actions and stuff that we say and do, if it does anything, then it inspires our listeners, you know, to do some good in this world, to be better people, to read more Superman stuff, because it's awesome. but you know, that's what the Krypton Report family is about, man. It's about inspiration. It's about hope and sharing the stories of Superman to give that hope. And I think we had a really great, powerful episode tonight. And you know, I just want to thank our listeners for listening.
I think that's a great place to put a pin in this. Like, this was a kind of special episode for us. So just remember to have hope and be inspired and inspire others, everyone. And remember,
look up in the sky.
Look up in the sky.
Look in the sky.